So last week, I made a video about a book which claimed that a child was healed by God of autism. In this video, we are going to kick it up a notch with the Natural Medicine Guide to Autism. And you bet there's a whole lot more to cover in this book. In fact, so much so that I only think we're going to be able to get through the first chapter in this video. But oh boy, do I have my work cut out for me. But let's start with the note to the readers, which basically says that this book is a guide and only a guide, and as such, you can't really use it as you would use a guide, because it's not as good as a genuine professional who actually knows what they're talking about. So take your child to one of those. Of course, they're only making this statement to cover their ass, but I ask you why they have to make this statement to cover their ass, in case the stuff within it doesn't work? Perhaps? I hope somebody that is genuinely looking at this book for what it claims to be, that they actually take this advice and think to themselves, oh, maybe I should see a qualified healthcare professional instead of reading a book about natural medicine. One can only hope. Let's go on over to the introduction, where it says, autism is an epidemic in the United States, and the incidence continues to rise at an alarming rate. Numbers. This dramatic increase tells us that autism is not a purely genetic disorder. The incidence of genetic disorders remains stable over time. While there may be a genetic component, there are clearly other contributing causes or triggers. Okay, when you look at the numbers and you see that the numbers are getting higher and higher every year, yeah, that seems scary. That makes you think, oh, autism really is on the rise. What's behind this? Is there anything we can do? How do we stop the whole world from becoming autistic? But you misunderstand. The diagnosis is on the rise, not necessarily the condition itself. Some possible causes include the fact that we are better able to detect symptoms and make a more accurate diagnosis of autism. There's the fact that we screen for autism more often now. There's the fact that we might even be over-diagnosing autism by screening children that are too young to be diagnosed. And on top of all of that, the definition and the diagnostic criteria of autism has been broadened several times. But you state that there may be environmental factors that increase the rates of autism. And that could be true, because there are some environmental factors that do contribute. Namely, older parents, especially an older father at the time of birth, and premature births as well. But it's kind of set from when the child is born, whether or not the child has autism. But to be clear, we have no idea whether the actual condition or conditions, because it's a spectrum, are actually on the rise, because all we know is that the diagnosis is becoming more prevalent. This book is here to tell parents of autistic children that you don't have to accept that there's nothing you can do for your child beyond remedial intervention to help them live more easily with their limitations. You also don't have to accept that pharmaceutical drugs are your only treatment option. Unlike the grim prognosis conventional medicine gives the disorder, natural medicine offers a positive, practical approach to autism. Identify the imbalances in the child's system, apply therapies to correct those imbalances, and autism can be ameliorated or reversed in many cases. You see, that right there is the crux. The crux of why this book exists. Why natural medicine, or should I say alternative medicine, or even better, pseudo-medicine, actually convinces some people. Because, see, conventional medicine, or more accurately, actual medicine, doesn't always have the answer. There are a number of conditions that if you or a loved one has, there's not really much you can do about it. And autism is one of those, because we haven't identified an exact cause. We haven't found a cure. The only thing we can do is, well, therapy. Teach the child how to cope, how to manage, how to interact, and how to be independent. And parents don't like that answer, because we don't like feeling that there's nothing we can do, especially when it's about our own children. And I can sympathize with that. I mean, at my age, I don't have children of my own, so I can only imagine what these parents and loved ones would be going through to try to help their child. And to have no solid answer, that's scary. And that's where pseudo-medicine comes in, because it offers that answer. We like to have a sure answer, especially something easy, something approachable, something accessible. We love having a miracle pill that can just solve all of our pretty deep problems. But sorry to say, reality sucks, and we don't have that. If you haven't guessed my stance on this book, it's that none of it actually works, and I'm going to explain why that is. So don't think that I'm just going to dog on this book without explaining my reasoning, but we'll get deeper into it in a minute. But to have this promise that doesn't actually work, or that doesn't hold up to what it says it does, it's pretty dangerous, because there are some people that will pick up this book right here, think it works, do all the stuff in this book, and never get their child's genuine, actual help, regardless of that note to the readers. That is why I am totally against pretty much all pseudo-medicine, because even if it's not harming the child, it may be taking away from methods that actually do work. The approach is based on treating the causes of an individual's condition, rather than seeking to suppress the symptoms as most drugs do. But here's the thing, the big issue, and the thing that you're not going to want to hear. We don't know the cause of autism. We don't. Now, this guide, of course, is going to say that they do, they figured it out, and they know how to help, but, no, they don't. Turns out, they actually didn't. Because if they did, then it wouldn't be natural medicine, it would be medicine. I can understand not wanting to just focus on symptoms and try to focus on, you know, the cause, but the symptoms are the only thing that we know we can help. We don't know the cause, and neither do you. The operative word here is individual. Treatment tailored to the individual is key to a successful outcome, because no two people, even with the same diagnosis, have the exact same imbalances causing their problems. Okay, here they're throwing out some concepts that are, well, easy to understand, simple to grasp, and they're trying to make it seem like they've figured it out. But as we'll see, they haven't. Treatment tailored to the individual being key is actually true of therapy. And I should say genuine therapy, like behavior therapy. That is pretty important when dealing with autism. But that's also a very common tactic in natural medicine and other pseudo-medicines, acting like they're focused on the individual and what you specifically need. And that gives it a more personal experience, but it doesn't work. And they also throw around the concept of imbalances, which is, again, a pretty common tactic in pseudo-medicine, to say that this is caused by an imbalance, or that is caused by an imbalance, and all you have to do is take supplements, eat this superfood that'll give you the nutrient that you're missing, and then you'll be good to go. And that does work for, well, nutrient deficiencies, but that's it. You're not going to heal autism by treating imbalances. But I'm getting ahead of myself. I think that's for another video. I use the term natural medicine because these therapies work with the body, not against it. This medical model recognizes the wisdom of the body. Another important aspect of natural medicine is the core principle upon which it operates, and that is do no harm. Unlike prescription drugs, which often have side effects ranging from mild to life-threatening, the therapies detailed in this book both treat your child's condition and do so without causing your child other problems. Natural medicine restores balance to the body at a profound level, rather than employing surface palliative measures. For this reason, I prefer the term natural medicine over alternative medicine. Yet, no matter which way you call it, it's still a pseudo-medicine, as in, it's not as effective as actual medicine. And by using the term natural medicine, you make it seem a bit more genuine, as if it actually works, when that's actually not the case. And that's a huge thing that alternative medicine, or natural medicine, or better, pseudo-medicine does. And it tries to pass itself off as just as good, if not better, than genuine medicine. Okay, I think this is a good point to really explain how pseudo-medicine works, and to tell you why I'm getting so worked up over all of this. So here are the several ways that pseudo-medicine works. The first of which being misinterpreted natural course. You see, some conditions will actually improve and maybe even go away on their own, and that includes things that you may not expect, like autism. And cancers, even. Not all cancers continue to grow and grow. And if you're trying to treat this with a natural medicine, then it may seem to actually work when your condition suddenly gets better, but it might have just done that anyways. Then, another cause is the placebo effect, which I'm sure you've heard of, which is basically a psychological factor where being convinced that a medicine or treatment will work actually causes the desired effects, simply because of your mental state. And this has been known and well documented for a long time now, and when an actual medicine is being produced, it has to be tested to make sure it works better than a placebo. Whereas a pseudo-medicine that doesn't actually do anything might seem to actually work solely because it's a placebo. What comes to mind is homeopathy. Lesser known, and still just as important, is the nocebo effect, which, if placebo is something working simply because you're convinced of it, nocebo is a medicine that actually does work, but because of your psychological state, if you're convinced that it does not, then it will actually cause the effects not to happen, because you're convinced that it won't. It's the opposite of the placebo effect. So you being convinced that this one particular medicine will not cure your child's behavior, and, well, teaching that to the child, could cause the medicine to actually not work, whereas the alternative, or pseudo-medicine, may still actually seem to work because of the placebo effect. And they brought up something else that's interesting, and that is the adverse effects, or lack thereof. Because, you see, some medications and treatments, while they do treat the symptoms or condition, depending on what it is, they may have side effects. And they could be pretty great, especially in situations where the condition is pretty critical, or it could potentially be fatal. And in those situations, it makes more sense to have medicine that is a bit riskier, because the risk outweighs the benefits. And that is going to put people off from wanting to get certain treatments. But alternative medicines offer an option that will promise no adverse effects, and probably won't have any adverse effects, because it won't have any effect other than placebo. But in doing so, they make their solution seem healthier, better for you, and that makes their offering seem better, maybe even healthier, or just more effective, because it's not causing you harm like the treatment would be. But that doesn't mean that it's actually treating what it says it's treating. And there are also situations where the alternative medicine will actually interfere with whatever standard treatment you're going through, and that will render it ineffective, but could also take away the side effects that you obviously don't want. So without the side effects, you feel better, you feel healthier, and you might feel like the alternative medicine is working, but it's actually rendering the treatment useless, and the underlying cause or symptoms is left untreated. You see, proper medicine, genuine medicine, is tested to rule out these components, making sure that this medicine does what it says it does, and it's not these other effects making it seem like it actually works. But, of course, pseudo-medicine is not held to that high of a standard, and dare I say that it relies on those effects to work. Might be a shocker to you guys, but that's how it is. And that's why they needed to put that disclaimer in the beginning of the book. Because, well, this hasn't been evaluated by the FDA, or really anyone except maybe the author anecdotally. But without ruling out all those effects, you can't know that what's in this book actually works. And, well, the science actually has been done for a lot of it that we're actually going to cover in future videos, but I'm going to spoil it all for you. This book, what's in it, doesn't actually work. And if you got triggered by that, we're going to go deeper into it. And that brings us to chapter one. What is autism? Now, most of this is pretty boring, and not all of it is worth talking about, although it is worth mentioning that this was written before the DSM-5, so in America, autism would still be the genuine diagnosis, whereas now they would be diagnosed with an autism spectrum disorder, as opposed to straight-up autism or Asperger's or PDD-NOS. But in Chapter 1, they do say, "The cause for the rise in autism is the subject of great debate and controversy. Some say it is an issue of awareness, but many longtime teachers who have seen the sharp increase of autistic behaviors in their classrooms, independent of diagnosis, would contest this view." Quite frankly, I don't care what teachers have to say about the apparent autism epidemic, because that's not for teachers to decide, it's for medical professionals and researchers. I've already talked about the potential, or I would say probable, causes for the rise in diagnoses, so I won't cover that again. But you're arguing that this is not simply a matter of awareness because teachers have noticed these behaviors more frequently. What's to say that once teachers become aware of these behaviors, that they don't then recognize them more and therefore perceive that there is a rise in these behaviors because now they're learning to point them out? And of course, now they've pointed them out more than they ever have before. Or that over time, they're just getting better at recognizing these behaviors because they might see little tiny things that they wouldn't have noticed before. This is anecdotal evidence at best, and not even very good at being anecdotal evidence at all, because they don't give a citation for this at all. No citation, so I guess I don't really have to argue against this too much, because without a citation, I could just say, nuh-uh, and that's just as valid as what they said. And then, the book says what we've all been waiting for. Many people, both autism experts and parents of autistic children, blame the increase on the rise in the number and nature of vaccines given to children. No. no experts blame vaccines. There was one study done back in 1998, and that study has been systematically debunked time and time again, and it was even retracted because the people who conducted the study realized the several faults in it. But people like you are still holding on to it, acting as if it's a genuine concern because it came from people actually in the field. But no, it's not a genuine concern. Vaccines do not cause autism. That much has been proven very, very much. But you need it to cause autism, because you need it to be a simple answer. You need it to be something that you can control, because if it's vaccines, we can just opt out of the vaccines and then no more autism. But no. Turns out, vaccines don't cause autism, and you perpetuating the lie that it does is very, very dangerous to public health. There have been several outbreaks of diseases like measles and whooping cough among, unsurprisingly, anti-vaxxers, and this would have been very easily prevented if they'd have only gotten vaccinated. But now they're afraid of it, and people like the author of this book are to blame, and they are taking us backwards when it comes to public health. And parents blaming vaccines? I don't give a and I have no reason to. The typical parent is not going to understand the ins and outs of neurodevelopmental disorders. They're not experts. They're just concerned people trying to find an answer where there is none. And it's tough. It's definitely a tough situation. But don't act like your mommy blog is just as reliable and just as good as genuine experts who actually know what they're talking about. But I want to respond to what they're saying here, because for now, they do mention that the rise in autism diagnoses coincides with the number of vaccines given to each child, but that by no means demonstrates that one causes the other. Good old correlation and causation. Maybe there's a third variable that this takes place in developed countries that have advanced medical knowledge, because those countries would be more likely to screen and diagnose autism and would be more likely to give vaccines because of their medical knowledge and more advanced healthcare. I don't want to say good healthcare across the board because I hate the US where I live, but that's neither here nor there. There are few things that properly me off. And one of them is when someone acts like an expert when they clearly don't know what they're talking about, acting as if their shallow knowledge and understanding can replace the professionals. As this book demonstrates, improvement and even reversal are possible when you can address the underlying factors in treatment. Many children who strictly met the criteria for a diagnosis of autism experienced significant improvement with natural medicine approaches. Yeah, no. No, there's not. There is no evidence that any alternative medicine actually helps people with autism, except tentative, and I stress tentative, evidence that music therapy might work, or help, rather. If there was enough evidence to say that a particular treatment worked, then it wouldn't be an alternative medicine, it would be medicine. See, children with autism may simply improve with time, especially if they are given special education and genuine behavior therapy. So I suppose you could see improvement while trying a natural pseudo-medicine, but that isn't to say that that's what's working. It could simply be natural course, as I talked about earlier, or just simply the actual treatment that they are getting working. All right, so that's going to be it for this video, and that's only the first chapter. There is, of course, more BS sprinkled in within that chapter, but I think you get the point. If I do more of this, then we're going to go much further in depth to all of this and really expose the pseudo-medicine for what it is, and hopefully some of you out there will learn to trust actual doctors and actual medicine that they learned in a real education. Natural medicine, homeopathy, acupuncture, essential oils, and yeah, even chiropractic are all bogus. So if you or a loved one need professional help, please seek a genuine professional. I'll be here to help you sift through the bullshit.